Let's worship the Lord our God. Good morning, everybody. God bless you all. Welcome to those of you that have visited us, and welcome to those that are joining us online this morning. My wife has a scripture for us, and I guess you're going to say hello to the one in various tongues.
Good morning, and Ale. Dios te bendiga. Muy buenos días. Shall we stand? Reading of the word. We read from Daniel, the book of Daniel, 2:1-23. In the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar had dreams. His spirit was troubled, and his sleep left him. Then the king commanded that the magicians and enchanters, the sorcerers, the Chaldeans, be summoned to tell the king his dreams. So they came in and stood before the king. And the king said to them, I had a dream, and my spirit is troubled to know the dream. Then the Chaldeans said to the king in Aramaic, O king, live forever. Tell your servants the dream, and we will show the interpretation. The king answered and said to the Chaldeans, the word for me is firm. If you do not make known to me the dream and its interpretation, you shall be torn limb from limb, and your houses shall be laid in ruins. But if you show the dream and its interpretation, you shall receive from me gifts and rewards and great honor. Therefore, show me the dream and its interpretation. They answered, second time I said, let the king tell his servants the dream, and we will show its interpretation. The king answered and said, I know with certainty that you are trying to gain time, because you see that the word from me is firm. If you do not make the dream known to me, there is put one sentence for you. You have agreed to speak lying and corrupt words before me till the time change. Therefore, tell me the dream, and I shall know that you can show me its interpretation. The Chaldeans answered the king and said, there is not a man on earth who can meet the king's demand, for no great and powerful king has asked such a thing of any magician or enchantress or Chaldean. The thing that the king asks is difficult, and no one can show it to the king except the gods, whose dwelling is not with flesh. Because of this, the king was angry and very furious, and commanded that all the wise men of Babylon be destroyed. So the decree went out, and the wise men were about to be killed, and they sought Daniel and his companion to kill them. Then Daniel replied with prudence and discretion to Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, who had gone out to kill the wise men of Babylon. He declared to Arioch, the king's captain, why is the decree of the king so urgent? Then Arioch made the matter known to Daniel, and Daniel went in and requested the king to appoint him a time, that he might show the interpretation to the king. Then Daniel went to his house and made the matter known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions, and told them to seek mercy from the God of heaven concerning this mystery, so that Daniel and his companions might not be destroyed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision of the night. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and forever, to whom belong wisdom and might. He changes times and seasons. He removes kings and set up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who are understanding. He reveals deep and hidden things. He knows what is in the darkness, and the light was with him. To you, O God, of my fathers, I give thanks and praise. For you have given me wisdom and might, and have now made known to me what we ask of you. For you have made known to us the king's matter.
Amen. Let us pray. Father God, Almighty God, Father, our maker, our creator, our leader, our guide, our sustainer, the one who gives so graciously, the one who gives so mercifully, the one who provides for his creation. Father, we come before you this morning with thanksgiving and praise. We come before you this morning, Father, and lift our hearts to you, lift our minds to you, lift ourselves to you, and just say thank you. Thank you. Thank you for this new day. Thank you that we have an opportunity today to live in this world and to proclaim the gospel. Thank you, Father, that you kept us alive, that you give us a heartbeat, that you give us breath in our lungs. Thank you, Father, that we opened our eyes this morning to greet this day. Thank you, Father, that we have this place to come together to worship you, to praise you, to gather around your word. Father, we thank you. Mighty God, King of the heavens, maker of all things. Father, forgive us when we fall into sin. Forgive us as we come before you and confess our own sin. For we know that you are just and right to forgive us when we confess sin. And there are many things, Father God, that we need to leave at your footstool. There are many things that we need to lay down. And I pray that you would work in us by your Spirit, by the wonderful work of your Holy Spirit, to convict us and lead us to that point where we can be honest and true to you and ask and beg and seek your forgiveness. Father, we pray for the outside community areas. We pray for those that live in this area, that they would be drawn into the wonderful gospel of Christ. We pray, Father God, that as your word goes out here, it also goes out there. Father, we pray for those that are missing from this fellowship this morning. And specifically, Father, we lift that unto Paul to you, Samuel's son, who has a blood condition, and we pray your wisdom and your touch to be with those that are working with him and dealing with him, and comfort to the parents. But above all things, now may we just focus upon you. Focus upon giving you the praise, the glory, the rightful honor that's due to your wonderful name. We ask all this in the precious name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Amen. Let us sing. Thank you.
Against the end.
self-supporting. And if you would like to give an offering or to missions, we support Matthew Kay and a missionary couple that is in French Guinea. The basket will be there, the whole service. So if you would like to give, thank you so much. And if not, anything happens. God bless you. Thank you so much.
Father, we thank you for the offering this morning. Father, you are the one that keeps the doors open. And this is where we light up here from you. So Father, we ask you, we give you thanks for the blessing this morning, this financial blessing that comes towards us, and pray that it's used responsibly and correctly, that these doors will remain open and your word will continue to go forth from this place, from this building. To your glory and to your honour and to your praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Mm-hmm. I have a small announcement this morning, just before we start the word. Mm-hmm. It's a good announcement, actually. We've been officially accepted into the World Reformed Fellowship. I think World Reformed Fellowship. Celebrate Life International. There we go. It's not a denomination or anything like that, but it's an oversight. It's a fellowship of Reformed churches that we now belong to. And those of you that know us here, we kind of stand alone. And so it's good to be in fellowship, yeah? It's the right thing to do. And so now we're in fellowship with those who are like-spirited, let's put it that way. As a church, we go through the Bible, verse by verse, book by book, word by word if necessary. And we're currently going through the book of 1 Peter. If you have a Bible, you might want to turn to 1 Peter, we're in chapter 2. And today we're going to be reading from 13 to 17, so we're going to get a lot done today. In the last few weeks, we've just been concentrating on one verse. But the Word of God is rich and powerful. And it's not to be taken lightly and just to be gleaned over. It's what I believe that the greatest calling of a pastor is to preach the Word correctly and understandably. So that the sheep hear his voice. And that's what the end of the day is what the church is for, the sheep. So before we get into the word, let us just pray, Father, that you open our eyes, you open our hearts, you open our spirits, Father, to your word. Open our minds to your word, that we may engage intellectually, and open our hearts to your word, that we may soften. Father, that your words are sharp and nearly two-edged sword. It will cut, it will divide, it will inflict injury in order to bring us around and bring us about. To be honest, in order to confess of our sins, in order to understand your word, we pray your spirit will illuminate that word within us and within me, that you will give us that understanding that can only come through your spirit, by your word. It is your word after all. You are the author of this word. Father, empty me of myself. I don't want any of me to be in there. And I pray that I may be the messenger, that Christ crucified, Christ risen, Christ the Lord, is the message. That we see, even through this word this morning, that Christ is there. The wonderful, amazing work, the amazing grace of our Father works through me and works through this word. And I pray that this day you open our eyes, that we go out of this place, we go out of this building, nourished, filled, and the word of truth, the word of God. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, I pray. Amen. 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 So let's turn to 1 Peter 2, 13 to 17. Be subject for the sake of the Lord to every human institution, whether to a king as to the one in authority, or to governors as sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and the praise of those who do good. For such is the will of God, that by doing good you may silence the ignorance of foolish men. Act as free people, and do not use your freedom as a covering for evil, but use it as slaves of God. Honour all people, love the brethren, fear God, honour the King. Amen. Peter, an apostle, the first one to speak out on the day of Pentecost, was a fisherman, a roughy, toughy fisherman, and he was filled with the Holy Spirit. And when we went through the introduction of this word, we knew that, and we found out that he was writing to dispersed churches, which is now in what we would class as Turkey. And they were predominantly Jewish converts, but amongst them was now becoming the spattering of the Gentiles, Samaritans. So the letter was written to all, as it's written to all of us today. This word is just as relevant to us today as it was when the Holy Spirit inspired Peter to write it. So there's nothing that's outdated, nothing that's old-fashioned here, because the more we read through the Bible, the more we can see that human nature sadly hasn't changed. We are still the same. Be subject for the sake of the Lord to every human institution, whether to a king as one in authority, or to governors as sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and praise of those who do good. Be subject to every human institution. We have a problem with that one, don't we, straight away? Well, it's a command, because it's to be obedient to your governing body. Stay within their laws. And it carries that sense of obedience as opposed to rebellion. To be subject to every human institution means be subject to it. Don't moan, complain, just put up and shut up and get on and be obedient. Very difficult. Very difficult. Paul in his epistle to the Romans writes the same. In Romans 13, verse 1 and 2, every person is to be in subjection to the governing authorities. Every person, he says there. For there is no authority except from God. Those which exist have been appointed by God. Therefore, whoever resists that authority has opposed the audience of God. And they have opposed will receive condemnation upon themselves. The Apostle Paul. And as Bettina read this morning, God appoints kings or governors or authorities. It's his doing. He appoints them. So this is a command. It's not a suggestion. And it's a tough one for us to deal with, especially in today's society that we live in. Keep the law, do what is right, do what is correct, whether you agree with it or not. In the Old Testament, we can see that from the end of King Solomon's rule, there were 39 good kings and evil kings that reigned over Judah and Israel combined. Of the 39 kings, there was only 8 good kings. The rest of them weren't good kings. I don't need to do the math. Every single king in Israel, actually, all 19 in Israel, were evil. When you read it, it says, and they done evil in the sight of God. Now, to say that God uses wicked men or people to carry out his plans is certainly not an admission on my part that he approves of their wickedness. I'm not going to say that. Or he's favourable to it. However, That's not to say that God cannot use the wicked deeds of people to accomplish his perfect and holy will. God's ways are above our ways, and we don't know. Every person will be judged for their deeds, 2 Corinthians 5:10 tells us that. It tells us that we must all appear before the judgment seat. And we will be recompensed for his deeds, according to what he has done, whether good or bad. Those without Christ, therefore, will be eternally separated from God to give an account for their deeds done in the body. Acts 1:15-19 and Acts 2:23 illustrate to us that God used evil acts by men to accomplish his plan to send in Jesus to die for our sin. All of us that were trusting him as Lord and Saviour. Genesis 45 reveals that Joseph revealed himself to his brothers, who sold him into slavery. They wanted him harm. They done evil to him. But he revealed himself to them and saved them from famine. So God uses evil, nasty, horrible people to accomplish his will. 2 Corinthians 1:8-11, Paul tells the Corinthians that God nearly killed him on his travels and his companions when they was in Asia. Why would God let that happen to the Apostle Paul? After all, Paul was doing God's work. Why would God do that? Well, Paul answers himself, so that we would not trust in ourselves, but God who raises the dead. Sometimes God will push you to the very, very limit, maybe even to death. And you listen. You wake up. There's too many people, let's say Christians, in inverted commas, that think heaven's given. I'm going to heaven regardless. Yet they don't know the first thing about our Saviour. They don't know the first thing about God, his attributes, who he is. They don't take the time to open the Bible, to read the Bible, yet they think they guarantee the pass in. And sometimes God may remind them such people, and he may put them in a position where all they've got left is to cry out to God. Now he uses evil deeds of evil people, sometimes for our good, to trust him in every situation. Paul also writes in Romans 8:28, I've got it on the screen there, that's a verse that we all know very well, I think. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good of those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. A little word there that often gets missed out. Or two words. To those who are called. Again, this is a verse that gets bandied around like it's some sort of magic thing. Well, God's going to do everything. No, he's not. But this verse can't simply be true unless God, in his infinite power, can take the evil deeds of evil men to accomplish good things for his people. Because God causes all things to work together for good. For what? What does he say there? For his purpose. This is very much maligned scripture these days, when people band it around. Well, God works all things out for the purpose of good. They miss that last little bit out. For his purpose, not yours. The Bible isn't about you, it's about God. That God uses evil for good is a powerful reminder that there is nothing that is impossible for God. God is over evil. So it's not impossible. So from here we can see already that Peter's opened up and said, be subject to every human institution. Well, for us today, how would we apply that? We've got governments, haven't we? Some of us still got kings and queens. Not that they do much anymore. But we have governments. We have local governing authorities, we have police. Regardless of whether they keep the law or not, it's not down to us to judge, but they are the ones that we need to be obedient to. We need to run our affairs. Our businesses, if we own a business or we run a business, but our everyday life in the confines of the government. Don't cheat, don't take bribes or carry out services that are illegal. And if you run a business, or you own a business, or you're in a business, and maybe you're under a manager or something, then keep everything above board, to be honest. Keep everything legal, everything above board, everything out in the open. Nothing under the carpet, as we would say. No little brown envelopes, or, as we also know about. Everything legitimate. Because how today the media love it when a Christian gets caught out.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know, I'm not going to judge some of these Christians that end up in the newspaper, whether in their faith and whatever, but the papers love it now. The news loves it now when a Christian gets caught out in an illegal deal, trading standards or conduct. They absolutely pile it on. There's not much news around at the moment, especially, so they love to pile it on. And they say, oh, this person was a member of this church, and they done this, and look what they've done. And then they move on to the next person. In fact, the word used in other translations is, from what we have here as the subject, is actually submit. Your Bible might have submit. It's probably a better translation. Submit. Submit's a thing to the Bible, yeah? Submit is a military term. It means to arrange in a military fashion under the commander to put oneself into an attitude of submission, obedience, and no questioning. The soldier does not question the commander. If you do, you'll pay the consequence, but you still have to do what you were told to do in the first place. As a citizen in the world under the civil law and authority, God's people are to live in a humble, submissive way. That world's hostile. That world's godless. That world's not nice. But we are children of God, and we should reflect that out there. Only when the government, in other words, will try to force us or Christian to do something which is against the law of God, then we have every right to stand up and say enough. And we've seen that happen a few times, especially in COVID. We saw a few churches that stood up and said, no, we can't take away our right to worship. You're not going to do that. They got fined, but the fines were overturned. If you look to that on YouTube, it's quite a lot about it. And there is times when the government will say, try and say to a church, you must. And unfortunately, as we can probably see now, it's happening often, is the government will get into the church, church or state, and enforce their rules upon the church, and the church will start to say, yeah, okay, fair enough. Roll over. Roll over. Roll over. And we can see that happening now more and more, especially sadly in the Church of England. Not all members of the Church of England, but basically the top synod is starting to soften and do what the government says and agree with certain things which are totally anti-Christian. Why? Why then? Why should we be submissive? For his name's sake. We carry his reputation. If you're known as a Christian, if people know you as a Christian, then you carry his name's sake and they will judge you. It's like we said the other week. God looks at the heart. Yes, he does. Amen. Praise God for that one. But the people around you see you. And they judge you. They see you. They hear you. They see what you do, how you conduct yourself. And they judge you on that. And they may judge you on that as saying, if that's Christianity, I don't know anything of it. Or they might say, well, that person really has got something special. They're watching. They're watching all the time. Being rebellious just brings dishonor to Christ in his name. Tough one, because we're still human, full of sinful nature, and stamp our feet and pat our tongue out. I don't like it, but we are to be submissive. Peter was careful to point out here that the Christians in society are representatives of Jesus Christ. It's exactly what he says. Therefore, regarding human government, we should respect the office, even though we cannot respect the man or the woman in the office. Again, in the military, this is known as you salute the rank, not the man. You don't respect the man, you respect the rank. An officer is your superior. They demand your respect even if you don't like them. And yes, we all make mistakes. None of us is perfect. But to knowingly, willfully act against the local laws and the bylaws is to bring shame to his own. Where you park, for example, in your car. Are you parking in such a way that it's causing another person problems? Because you're so selfish and lazy that you don't want to walk. You just want to park on the double yellow line or the disabled bay. Yes, simple little things to the law. Be submissive to the law. When you're speeding down a motorway, and I've been on the receiver end of this, someone going faster than the speed limit, and if they have the accident, it's normally the other person that pays the price. Keep within the law, then you haven't got a problem. It's very difficult, I know, and we do make mistakes, but a lot of these mistakes we can control, don't we? Jesus, the disciples, the prophets, they was all accused of doing wrong before the governing bodies, all of them. Often to the death penalty. And they had done no wrong. But they didn't start a rebellion, did they? They didn't start a GoFundMe. They didn't go on Facebook and suddenly, oh, let's get a petition or anything like that. They didn't get a crowd. But you can read about them, can't you? You can read about them in the Gospels. You can read about them in Acts. They stood silently before their accusers. Paul actually offered to go to Caesar. He knew what was coming. Jesus led like a lamb to the slaughter. That should be our attitude. Verse 15 says, for such is the will of God. There you go. Such is the will of God that by doing good you may silence the ignorance of foolish men. The question that everybody asks, what is the will of God? Well, there it is. Be obedient. What's the will of God to my life? Be obedient. What does God want me to do? Be obedient. But be obedient to who? Be obedient to the word of God. Be obedient to God. Be obedient to the governing authorities. Consider others before yourself. Conduct yourself in such a way that those who are close to you, those around you, can find no controversy in you. That's the will of God. The will of God's not anything fancy. Be obedient. Simple. Shouldn't be a problem. Why do we struggle so much with it? Because we're sinful. People are watching. And probably, more than likely, they're watching and waiting for a time when you fail. And they can point and go, ha ha ha. Ha ha ha. They want to watch you till you fail and your faith becomes nothing but a joke. Depends how well your faith is rooted and how obedient you've been. But a lot of people are waiting for you to fail. I think we see that, and I think that those of us that have lived here for a while see that a lot I certainly see it in the expat English community, that a lot of them expect that a new person comes over, how long they going to last? How long are they going to last? How long is that business going to last? They're expecting them to fail. What a horrible attitude. Rather than saying, well done, you've made a big move from your country to start a life here. How can we help you? But we're not. They look like, that's going to last 5 minutes. They're going to lose all their money. That's not going to work. We judge and we wait for them to fail. How wicked of us. Maybe others are buying it. The way you keep your cool in difficult situations. You never speak ill of people. You never lose your temper. You never get mad. You never stamp your foot. Maybe that's what they're watching. Who knows? But they see an outward expression of your faith. And they will work out from that more than you whether your faith is genuine or not. And that's what they will see Christ in you. Do they see Christ in you? Or they see phoning? Are they, if you're acting in such a way that is good and obedient, then what are they seeing in you? They're seeing the fruit of the Spirit. And how do they see that? Because obviously, to be obedient, you're walking in the Spirit. And if you're walking in the Spirit, you will bear the fruit of the Spirit. And without being too weird or anything, fruit is attractive, yeah? Fruit's attractive. It's nourishing. You all go to the supermarkets and you see the nice display of the apples and apples and oranges. Sometimes you don't even like apples and oranges, but you still probably buy them and say, oh, they look nice. If that's how you should be in your life. Attractive like that. Not you, not the person, but the person within you, the Holy Spirit coming out of you, displaying the fruits. And when we live our lives out in public in such a way, that's not through your works, okay? It's not your effort. It's not you put on a good show. It's Christ in you that shines from you. That is what it is to live and to walk in the Spirit as a Christian. Be obedient to the word. Love one another. We hear this all the time, all the way through the New Testament. Love one another. Love one another. Put others before yourselves. It's always there. The most important thing, I think, in this text is to put all of our social and political life into relation to God. How does our social life, how does our political life relate to God? Do we put him first and everything else underneath? Because the Bible is not a book about how to get along in the world. It's a book inspired by God about how to live for God. And this is why today we see so many undernourished Christians, because they do not feed on the Word of God. They watch some guy on TV or on YouTube or podcast for 5 minutes. Or they go to church, unfortunately, and hear a weak sermon that has no meaning, no substance, no nothing. And they walk out the door and forget it. But the Word of God is nourishment to our souls. We need to know the Word of God. Because it says here in verse 15, such is the word of God, that by doing good you may silence the ignorance of foolish men. Submit to human institutions, silence ignorance of foolish men. We touched on this a little bit last week. There's nothing worse, is there, when you end up having an argument with someone about your faith. They say something, you fire something back. You see it all the time. You maybe have it vocally. You may, normally these days people tend to argue more on social media. They put something on, and someone puts something else on, and somebody puts something, it ends up with this great big old thing of everyone, Christians, pulling each other down. That's ignorance, foolishness. Don't get involved in those sort of things. Again, if you conduct yourself in a way by being obedient to God's word, you won't get involved in such situations. And this is what Peter's saying. For such is the will of God, that by doing good, you may silence ignorance of foolish men. They can't push nothing against you. They may try, but they can't hold anything against you, technically. We all know that word, we say, you throw enough mud and some of it will stick. But sometimes it doesn't. If you live your life beyond reproach. Look at some of the famous Christians. I know he's a bit cringy these days, but Cliff Richard, for example. Good Christian boy. Been all through the 50s, the 60s, all of that life. And people have tried so many times to slander him. They even had a BBC tip-off that they found stuff in his house which wasn't even real, yet they condemned him already. Tried so many times, he shouldn't slow down yet. He's still there. And he still maintains his faith. Doesn't talk bad about anyone. In fact, the most wonderful thing about Sir Cliff, not a big fan of this, by the way, but he sued the BBC for what they did. He sued them because they falsely accused him of put it on the marriage before he even knew about it. So he said, we've got a lot of money. And what did he do with that money? He booked the Royal Albert Hall for 2 nights and paid for everyone to come, all his friends that supported him, and done a concert for him for free. That's good witness, eh? Just for example. Those around you in your everyday life are ignorant of the gospel of Christ. Yes and amen. As you once were. Yes and amen. 1 Corinthians, for the word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is what? The power of God. People will always find something bad. They'll always criticize. They criticize anyone and everything, no matter how good they are. And take our Lord as an example. They criticized him. They accused him. But when we endeavor to walk and to live in the Spirit, being obedient to his word, normally the best they can do is criticize your faith, of which they know nothing about, because they're ignorant of it. This is what Peter's saying. They're ignorant and foolish. So they'll criticize your faith. They'll say things like, call yourself a Christian. But they don't know the first thing about Christianity. They don't know. What did Jesus tell us? Blessed are those when they insult you and persecute you and falsely say all kinds of things against you because of me. Matthew 5:11. Sermon on the Mount. Let's turn quickly or look on the screen. John 15. John 15:19-20. If you were of the world, the world would love you as his own. But because you're not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, again, he chose us, we didn't choose him, but I'm not getting into that today. Because of this, the world hates you. Yes, they do. The world hates you. Other Christians don't like you sometimes either. Especially when you start talking about that, I'm not getting there. Remember, the word that I said to you, a slave is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. The words are there. If they kept my words, they will keep yours also. As Christians, we should not be surprised that unbelievers in the world hate us. It follows the pattern, doesn't it, of the world since Cain murdered Abel. And he's seen in the world's reactions to Christ himself. Just as Jesus experienced opposition and persecution, his disciples can expect the same. Pick up your cross. Doesn't say get in your Mercedes anywhere, does it? Doesn't say you go to your big mansion, go to your house, get in your checkmate, it says pick up your cross. That means this is going to be hard. Forgive everything, forget everything, give up everything. Doesn't say check your bank account every morning. Our reward on this earth may not come. We may not ever see it. We may not ever be realised. But it will come in heaven. We're not to build up houses of sand, are we? We're to build up the world of the kingdom. And Peter continues in verse 16. Act as free people. I love that. Act as free people. Do not use your freedom as a covering for evil. But use it as slaves of God. Slaves, that's the correct word, doulos, slaves. Not servants, slaves. Slaves are bought at a price to do a job. That's it. Not to question the master, you do not need to do it. So the correct translation is slaves. All believers should enjoy our freedom in Christ, yeah, for sure. But it must not be an excuse to put on a mask or put on a veil and to cover up what really is wickedness. I mean, we've seen this a few times. As Christians, we are still fallen humans, and we are still more than able to manipulate people because of our faith. I can't remember the name of the series we're watching. What's that series? It's a true story. It's just out on BBC. But it's about a Christian guy who gets duped by another Christian guy. He uses his faith as a veil and he ends up murdering him. It's a true story, happened in England. And then he moves on to another Christian woman. He used his faith, his cross around his neck, he's doing good works, doing good deeds, going to the church, doing this, saying all the right things. He used it as a veil. But he used it to line his pockets because he got himself on their will and then got their money, or so he thought. So $2 million, I think it was all got money. As Christians, remember, you're still a fallen human. And you're still more than able to manipulate people, and even manipulate people because of your faith. And we hear this, thankfully, not so much, well, not at all here, but don't we hear this, sadly, in Christian circles, when you do something, they say, what would Jesus do? That's manipulation. That's not violence, that's not loving one another, that's accusing. What would Jesus do? We are still fallen humans. We are still full of that sinful nature. I received so many emails, and a lot of them start really great. Good morning, Pastor. God bless you. Blessings upon you and your family, and the wonderful work you're doing there. La 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 la. I'm running a small children's mission in out of Mongolia, and we was promised $1 million by some fund that the $1 million hasn't arrived, and we're $1 million in money. And I get them all the time, probably 3-4 times a week. They use Christ, they use Christianity, faith. Now whether they're genuine, I don't think they are, they get straight in the spam box. Whether they're Christians, I don't know. I will never know. But you can smell a rat. God gives us discernment and a sound mind. I mean, you don't need rocket science for that one. But the punchline is always there. Money. Very rarely do I get one that says, may I ask you and your fellowship to pray for us? Mm-hmm. Very rarely. Matthew paid. Yes, we get there. But most of the time it's, hi, church, give us some money. And we need to be careful. We need to be careful in the business. We need to be, if we're responsible and we own the business to the public, that we do everything again. It's coming back to the same thing. Everything legal, everything above board. Not to be able to coerce, not to be able to misrepresent what we do. Lulling people into false insecurity because they go, well, he's a Christian, he must be okay. He goes to church, he must be okay. Wake up. Freedom in Christ must be used wisely. And that's why Peter says, do not use your freedom as a covering for evil. It may be understood either as an excuse made up before the fact or the act, a reason for wrongdoing, or after the fact to cover up the wrongdoing. Well, you know, I was doing that with the best intent. Christian freedom is never to be used as an excuse for self-indulgence. It is never to be used as a license to do as you please, which is why Peter adds, as servants of God, as slaves of God. Remember who you are. Christian freedom rests not on escape from our service, but on a change of masters. We're no longer mastered by Satan, we're now mastered by God, yeah? He's our master, he bought us from that kingdom into his kingdom. He paid the price on the cross to transfer us from there to there. So our master is no longer the worldly master. Our master is the holy master. Honour all people, he says in verse 17. Love the brethren. Fear God. Honour the king. Tough one for us in England, don't know. See what that ever read, not my king. So highly esteem, that is, that's the idea, not just refers to being obedient, but it actually means to be in an inner obedience, a duty, a respect. Brethren, of course, is brotherhood. What it means? brotherhood is obviously then what? The church. Some translations actually use brotherhood, and this is interesting. I'm just going to nip off a little bit here. Because in the Greek, the word for brotherhood is aradelphos. Aradelphos in Greek. And it comes from two words, a, which denotes unity, and delphos, which actually means womb. Therefore, it carries the meaning of those born from the same womb. Wow, how powerful the Greek word is. We are brotherhood. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. Hallelujah, amen. It defines a brotherly and sister relationship, and in this case speaks of a whole fraternity of Christians. As people of God, believers have obligations to God which involve earthly relationships. Not the least of these is to love the others, love your brothers and sisters. A continual, recurring theme throughout the New Testament. Love one another, love one another, love one another, love one another, love the fellowship. I put it up there the other month when we done Galatians. I had everything, the brotherhood, love, 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 love. As with honour, as we're showing that agape, selfless, unconditional love, that is a reflection of a regenerate new heart. That's the attitude of a spirit-filled life. That's the attitude of someone who's submissive and obedient to the word of God in all things. That's what it means. Honour all people. Love the brethren, fear God, honour the king. These four commands show us what submission looks like. See, Peter started with submit, and now he's writing it down for you. Honour all people, love the brothers, fear God, honour the king. Can't get much plainer. Some people are not honourable, but honour them anyway, for the sake of your kingdom. Some people are not lovable, but love them anyway, for the sake of your God and kingdom. There is no escape clause attached to this verse, this is it. It's not suggestion, it's not a good idea, it's not like, oh, there's none of that. This is honour all people, love the brethren, fear God, honour the king, full stop. These commands show us that submission is first and foremost a matter of what? The heart. It's a heart matter. So the appeal is either to recognise the value of every person as a bearer of the image of God, or what is more likely in this context is to respect those in positions of authority. Fear God, which is something that they're not doing. They don't fear God, have they? They're miles away. Broad is the road that leads to heaven, narrow is the gate that leads to righteousness. For the unbeliever, the fear of God is the fear of judgment, and the fear of God is eternal death, which means eternal separation from God. This is why we are to bear witness to our God. This is why we are to tell everybody we know the gospel of Christ. It's not our job to convert them, it's our job to tell them. What they do with that after that is up to the Lord. He can do the rest. You are not the Holy Spirit. He will do that. But it's your job, our job, every believer, to preach and to teach and to tell the gospel. Fear God. If you don't fear God, then you won't, because it doesn't mean that much to you. But Peter is writing to believers. He's not writing to non-believers. Non-believers aren't going to pick up the book of Peter and read it. Are they? They're not going to have no interest in that. He's writing to believers. The church is what for? The church is for who? Believers. The church isn't supposed to be a social club or community centre. You are the social club and the community centre when you go out there. But the church, it's for the people of God. It's his bride. So his bride is not going to have pagans in it, is it? He wants sheep. My sheep hear my voice. The goats don't understand. And as RC says, you don't change the menu for the goats. You feed the sheep and you don't give the sheep goats sheep's food and you don't give the sheep goats food. We are to feed the sheep. That's the job of the church, to feed the word of God. For the believer, the fear of God is really something much different. When we respect him, when we obey him, when we submit to his discipline, we worship him in awe. Have you ever thought about how awesome, how mighty, how great God really is? Have you ever sat down in your prayer time in the morning? My Father. Stop there. My Father. My Father. My Father who created the heavens and earth. I can call you Father. My Father who created every molecule, every animal, every bug. And I can call you Father. Awesome. Amazing. And then you think about how great, how big, and how awesome he is, and how he can just in a second go, nothing happens. No more breath, no more heartbeat. That's how awesome he is, and that's how we should fear him. That's the proper fear. It's respecting him, obeying him, submitting to him, worshipping him. Like when we were children, our fear of discipline from our parents when we know we've done something wrong. The same should be true with our God. We should be fearful when we disobey him. Not because he's going to punish us, but we let him down. Done it again. We should fear his discipline and therefore seek to live our lives in the way that pleases him. No one likes being disciplined. No one likes it. But when you step out of line, expect it. If he loves you. If you're not getting disciplined, then what question is salvation? A healthy adoration for God will have an element of knowledge that God can be fearsome. In Hebrews 10:31, what does it say? If you remember, it's a frightening thing to fall into the hands of a living God. As sinful people, we have every reason to fear God's judgment. It's part of a motivation to be reconciled to God. That was what led me to become a Christian. When I suddenly realised that God is real. God is real and he's bigger than me and I've got to get my life together. So let's conclude and then we look at this. Application and then we're going to gather around the Lord's table. Human governments are created by God. We read that earlier in the reading. And rulers are God's servants. He puts them in place. Even if the rulers are not believers, they are still God's men officially. Even if they are dictators and tyrants, their rule is still better than no rule at all. Because the complete absence of any rule is what? Chaos. Anarchy. No society can continue under anarchy. It will implode, it will self-destruct. So even with an evil government, even if, let's take for example, Adolf, it still had some form of control. Imagine when it hasn't got any form. Look what's happened in some of the eastern countries since they pulled out of dictators, like Iraq and Libya. It's chaos. The countries are imploding on themselves because there's no leadership, there's no government, there's nothing there. So order is better than chaos, even if it's evil. If Peter could command the Christian community to honour the king and the governor, he knew the wickedness of Nero. And Nero was a bad guy, yeah? And how much more must we honour our leaders, even though they may endorse and promote acts that we regard as wrong? In Peter's day, there were groups of zealous Jews who recognised no king but God and paid no taxes to anyone but to God. Believers, by contrast, then, he's saying, are to be model citizens, submitting themselves to human governments, realising that those governments are ordained by God, and Peter commands all believers to what? Submit. And as citizens in the world under civil law and authority, God's people are to live in a humble, submissive way in the midst of any hostile, godless, slandering society. And Peter explains in this section that believer submission to the institutions of this world is an act of tribute to God over the authorities and the institutions of the world. You're basically showing, like everyone else, I'm putting up with this, but I'm a citizen of God. I'm sitting there. We're not here for long, guys. This is passing through. This isn't our home. We shouldn't get so wound up about what goes on sometimes. This world's falling to pieces anyway. Bible tells us that, yeah? Revelation. This earth's going to pass away. This is why all this climate rubbish going on. The idea really is here is you can look a king or a prime minister or someone in authority in the eye and say, I submit to you. I honour you. Not for your sake. I honour you for God's sake. I honour you because God owns you and rules over you. God does own you and rule over them, regardless of whether they know him or not. And God has sovereignly raised you up for a limited season and given you leadership that you have. And for his sake, and for his glory, and because of his rightful authority, I honour you. This passage then is addressing our character, our conduct in public and in private. So the overarching question is, and here's your application. What do others see in you? Do they see Christ in you? Or do they see someone of the world? Is your conduct Christ-like? Are your words, your actions, your conduct, your deeds, do they reflect the Saviour whom you confess to obey and to follow? Are you willing to go the extra mile? To speak the truth, however it may offend. In your private life, for example, as we read in Scripture, when you look in the mirror, who is it looking back at you? Is it a struggling saint? A real struggling saint that's just like, one more day, or one more time. Is that the person looking back at you? Or is it a hardened, callous, bitter complainer fighting for my way, my life? I want this, I want that, I don't care what costs, I don't care who I have to walk over. I don't care whether it costs me my family, I don't care whether it costs me that someone is disobedient to the word of God. Now only you can answer them questions. But then the final question would be, you need to make some changes there. Be subject to authority. I'm going to remind you of this, and you should know this, but I'm going to remind you. Listen, this is important. God is omnipresent. Omnipresent means what? He's everywhere at all times. There's nothing he doesn't know about you. God is omniscient, which means he knows everything. And he knows everything about you. So he sees and he knows everything about you. All your actions. Lots of things you might do without even realizing. You might think you can get away with it. Because you've not been caught out. But one day you're going to have to face God. No one else, by the way, no attorney to defend you. There's going to be you and God. And he's going to say, what did you do with your life that I gave you? He's the judge of judges. And is he going to say to you, welcome in, my good and faithful servant? Or is he going to say, the highest authority, the highest judge, has seen and does see and witnesses all your works, all your deeds, and all your words. What do you have in your defense? If you believe, if you're obedient, our Father's ear is just a prayer away. Our honest and humble confession is, yeah, a breath away. redeem the time. For time is short. This is not our home, we're just passing through. And let's use that passing to some good, something permanent. Let's honour God before we honour anything else. When you get that in position, when you get Him in the right place, everything else falls into place. Do you trust Him? Do you trust Him enough for that? He's sovereign, but do you trust Him? Are you willing to let go of your ideas and attitudes against people and governments and so forth and say, I submit. No more big mouth, I submit. I humble myself. Are you willing to admit that you're a sinner? Are you willing to admit that you're being disobedient? You know the word of God, you know exactly what the word of God says, but I'm going to do it anyway. I'm going to do this because, you know. I don't know how many times I've heard this from people that get married. They get married to an unbeliever. You tell them, you advise them, listen, the Bible. It's not a command, but it really does sort of suggest that you don't do this. It's, you know, there's quite a lot in there that says, you know, be obedient to the word of God. And, no, I love him. It's going to work out. And then a few years later, bang. You never see him in church anymore. Or fails. They're going to take their kids to church, and dad says no, or she says whatever. See this so many times, over and over and over again. Why? Disobedience to the word of God. They know it. It's in the head, it's not in the heart. Toughen it, the word of God. Sharpen it in two-edged swords. Cut through the bone to the marrow. Really challenges and makes us think, wow, what a mess I am. It really hurts. It is the truth. And it's the truth that leads us into freedom. And it's an amazing truth. We're going to gather around the Lord's Supper now. He's going to pass it out to me. The communion is the result of our union with Christ. Believing and being faithful to his word. So we share common thoughts, feelings and experiences and beliefs. We share in the death, we share in the burial, we share in the resurrection. And most importantly, we share in the return of the Son of God. This is foundational to our salvation. And that death to self is symbolized in the ordinance of communion. Participation here is for all believers who are walking in fellowship with the Lord and each other, loving one another. It's an act of obedience to the scriptures. It's an act of worship to those of us that have a personal faith in Christ Jesus. We're all worthy to partake of the Lord's Supper. However, biblically there are people that should not take communion. This table here is not open to those who are not born again. This table is not open to those who are living in known and unconfessed sin. If a person has no union with Christ, then they have no act of taking communion. It's no certificate. In fact, they may even be bringing judgment upon themselves by practicing hypocrisy, and it may place them in danger. For partaking in communion, each of us should personally examine his and her heart and motives. As is written in 1 Corinthians 11, 1 Corinthians 11, 28, 29, everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves. And Paul wrote that he received from the Lord that which he passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, in the night he was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body which I do for you. Do this in remembrance of me." We have these little cups. They're a bit strange, but we got them during COVID. You take the little top layer off and there's a wafer in there which represents the body, and then underneath it's a bit and underneath is the non-alcoholic representation of the wine cell. That's what we're doing. Let us stand.
Awesome.
God didn't give it to me. We'll continue to write in Corinthians. Then, in the same way after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this, whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me, for whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." He's coming. Father, we thank you for this cup. We thank you for what it represents. Your word tells us that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. And you shed your blood once and for all on our behalf. So as you lift this cup before you, we thank you for it, we honor you for it, we understand the implications of it. And we lift it up and say, until you come again, so the glory is done. Amen. Let's remain standing and we'll sing our final song. Thank you for joining us this morning. Goodbye, everyone.